محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة.
الحمد لله الحمد لله خالق الوجود من العدم وجاعل النور من الظلم ومخرج الصبر من الألم فملقي التوبة على الندم فنشكره على المصائب كما نشكره على النعم ونصلي على رسوله الأكرم للشرف الأشم والنور الأتم والكتاب المحكم وكمال النبيين والخاتم سيد ولد آدم الذي بشر به عيسى بن مريم ودعا لبعثته إبراهيم عليه السلام حين كان يرفع قواعد بيت الله المحرم فصلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أتباعه خير الأمم الذين بارك الله بهم كافة الناس العرب منهم والعجم الحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل وكبره تكبيرا والحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا والحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله يأمركم أن تؤدوا الأمانات إلى أهلها وإذا حكمتم بين الناس أن تحكموا بالعدل إن الله نعم ما يعظكم به إن الله كان سميعا بصيرا يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم فإن تنازعتم في شيء فردوه إلى الله والرسول إن كنتم تؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر ذلك خير وأحسن تأويلا رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقده من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا اله الا الله اللهم اجعلنا من الذين امنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر امين يا رب العالمين الله عز وجل in Surah An-Nisa, as I've talked to you about it on different occasions, has given us guidelines for how to function as a society. And this is one of the earlier surahs given to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in the city of Medina, when Muslims were now just coming together as an organized society. Some of the phrases in Surah An-Nisa, some of the instructions that Allah has given are, you can think of them as rules for life. They're not just for a specific situation. There are things like that in Surah An-Nisa that are for specific situations. And there are other things that are basically things you gotta remember every day. Things that you and I need to live by. And the language with which Allah Azza wa Jalla speaks has to be paid attention to. It's not just that Allah has given a command often in the Quran, or He told us to do something or not do something. The halal and the haram, or the mandate, or the prohibited. But sometimes you have to pay attention to exactly how Allah expressed the importance of certain commands. So Allah Azza wa Jalla, for example, if He wants to tell us to be honest, or to fulfill the trust that we've been given, He could just say, أَدُّ الْأَمَانَاتِ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَدُّ الْأَمَانَاتِ Those of you who believe, fulfill the trust that you've been given, do right by anything that you've been entrusted with. But Allah begins this ayah, He says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّ الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا It's very interesting language. There's no doubt, in fact, it is Allah, He commands you that you give rights and you give trusts and you give them fully to those who deserve them. You give trusts to those who deserve them. Now this statement could have been made a lot briefer, and the Arabic principle is خَيْرُ الْكَلَامِ مَا قَلَّ وَدَلَّ The best kind of speech is when you use less words and you get your point across. That's true in any language. But Allah Azza wa Jal here used a much longer phrasing to say the same thing. So it deserves attention. Allah went out of His way to express things in this way. The first thing to note here is that Allah said, Inna Allah, that's certainly Allah. Or without a doubt, it is in fact Allah. He's the one telling you to do this. Because oftentimes, the trust that we're talking about is not a trust between us and Allah, it's between people. So to start off with a simple example, everybody here that drove here has a driver's license, right? And the state of Texas, or whatever state you're from, trusted you to drive your car responsibly, abiding by the laws of the road. They trusted that you're going to stop at a red light. They trusted that you're going to pause at a stop sign. They trusted that you're going to indicate before you change lanes, or you're not going to go recklessly speeding on a highway and things like that. They trusted you with those things, you abided by it, and now they're not checking every time you start your car. They're not checking at you on every turn you take. There's a trust between the government that issued you the permission to use the roads and yourselves. And so at that point, you would think that if, nobody's watching and I kind of cut the stop sign, or a lot of people have those cop detector things on their car, right? So if it doesn't go boop, 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 maybe I can go 30, 40 miles extra on the highway, go a little faster. Let me see if I can hit 100 on my car. If you're thinking like that, you're thinking, well, it's not a problem because the cops didn't find out. It's not a problem because the state trooper didn't find out. It's not a problem because the police didn't find out. And according to this, it is a problem because that trust that they gave you, Allah is the one, no doubt, that commanded that you fulfill it. Inna Allaha ya'murukum an tu'addu al-amanat ila ahliha. That's not the violation is not just between you and the one who gave you a trust. You just violated something Allah commanded. You understand that the mindset of the Muslim changes. You get a job, you get hired. And sometimes in your job, there's people around you that are doing the same thing that could be done in 4 hours. And they're doing it in 40 hours. They take the entire week to do the job. And you look at that culture in your office and you're like, maybe I should take it easy too. I mean, everybody else is slowed down. Why do I have to look like that? And then they're going to look at me funny because I'm doing my job. And you're making us look bad, bro. You're going to make the department look, make us, what are you trying to get a promotion? Is that what it is? So maybe I should also violate the trust that my employer gave me. And I should also kind of chill out and take it easy. I could have that mindset. Everybody else is taking a break. I could take a break too. It's not a big deal. Nobody minds. But that trust was not given to you by your manager. The manager doesn't pay your check. The company pays your check. And the company had an understanding that you will make full use of your time. Now, this is a lot of people come and ask the question, no, but sometimes there really isn't any work to do. What do you want me to do? Well, if your employers know that there's no work to do and you want to sit there and play, Crossy Road, or you want to play Angry Birds on your phone, if they know, then they know. If they know, then they know. And for some people, this is even more strange because the employer is paying you
to do your job, and you're using that time to listen to Islamic lectures. If they're okay with that, that's something else. But if you're supposed to be doing your job, and you're like, no, I want to do something, that's un-Islamic. What you're doing is un-Islamic because you're violating a trust that was given to you. If they're okay with it, that's something else. But if they're not, if they don't even know, and you're doing it behind their back, then this is an amana you're not giving back. You're violating a trust. The same thing happens with kids at school. When our children are, you know, being entrusted, like, you know, for old, not just older kids whose college tuition sometimes the parents are paying, right? But even younger kids, when you're providing for their schooling and their transportation, and, you know, they get to a certain age where they have a pretty well-developed conscience, when they're cutting classes or they're not doing their homework or they're not paying attention in school, they need to understand something. They're not just getting away with it at the school, or they're not just violating the rights of their parents. Their parents entrusted them with something. It's not an easy thing to put up, to afford an education for our children. It's not an easy thing. And when you've been entrusted with that, that you're going to make good use for it. Or kids ask, can I have a phone? Can I have a phone? Which is like asking, can I have a nuclear device? But we're okay with giving our kids phones nowadays. Okay, here's a phone and here's, you know, 5G. Take it. Do what, because of course you'll only use it for halal, so it's okay. Because the human being, my children, because they, you know, because we come from a Muslim family and we have last names like Muhammad and Ali and whatever, therefore we are genetically incapable of doing anything wrong with our cellular devices. So it's completely fine. You go ahead. You're not like the other kids. So you're okay. And we hand it over. We don't even train our children with this principle that you have to take something and you have to give it its full right. When you're being entrusted with something, that means nobody's watching over you and you're still doing the right thing. And it is Allah who commands you to do that. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. I talked to you about traffic, I talked to you about employers, I talked to you about kids at school, you know, even older kids whose your parents are paying for your college tuition, and you're skipping classes and hanging out with your friends in the student lounge, you're violating a trust that Allah gave you. Allah gave you that. They spent sweat and tears to earn that income to pay for your college tuition, and you're going to go play ping pong? And you're going to do whatever else and not do your assignments? And not put your heart and soul into your education? I don't feel like it. I'm not sure what my major is yet. And this guy's in college for like 4 years and they're like, what's your major? Still deciding. You're still deciding? You know, this is the violation of amana that has been given to you. The blessing that has been given to you. And it's not okay to do that. And it goes even further than that. This one small statement, it is in fact Allah. He's the one commanding you to fulfill the trust that you've been given to those who deserve them. To do right by people when they trust you with something. In simple English, if you've been trusted with something, do right by it. Just because somebody can't catch you or they're not there, don't go behind their back and say, well, they didn't find out, so it's okay. So it's okay. It's the same kind of trust that exists in family relations. It's the same kind of trust that exists between husband and wife. Not everything has to be spelled out. But a husband knows that, you know, my wife wouldn't like this, this, or this. Well, she's not here, so it's okay. But she trusted me. She trusted me, so I shouldn't be doing that. And the same way the other way around. The wife knows the husband shouldn't be, you know, the husband wouldn't like it if he found out. He wouldn't be happy. He would think it's a violation of his trust. But it's okay because he's not here. And nobody took a picture, right? So it's okay. Nobody recorded it, right? So it's okay. I got away with it. But Allah is recording it. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. This is a commandment from Allah. This is not just a violation of a relationship. This is a violation of Allah's commandment. And we have to understand life that way. That every trust that we live with, when we're not able to fulfill it, is one thing, you know, إِذَا قُلْتَ فِي شَيْءٍ نَعَمْ, the Arab poet says, إِذَا قُلْتَ فِي شَيْءٍ نَعَمْ فَأَتْمِمْهُ فَإِنَّ نَعَمْ دَيْنٌ. You know? So he says, if you're going to say yes to something, then you better do it. If you agree, then you better fulfill it. You know? فَإِنَّ نَعَمْ دَيْنٌ عَلَى الْحُرِّ وَاجِبُ. For a decent person, once you say yes, you've been obligated. I'm taking it a step further from the poet, based on the Quran. Once you said yes, Allah obligated you. Allah obligated you. And you're like, well, I can't do it. Well, if you can't do it, then go back and say, you know, فَإِلَّا فَقُلْ لَا. And if you can't do it, just say no. Or I can't do it anymore. Be open about it. Honest about it. Instead of being dishonest. You know? And so this is the mentality that we have to reintroduce into the ummah. Oftentimes, we're violating a trust and we're too afraid to be honest about it. You're violating it. You're already doing something wrong, but I don't want to hurt this person's feelings. Understand something. Forget about hurting anybody's feelings. You're right now displeasing Allah. That's a bigger problem than hurting anybody else's feelings. And you have to realize, who are you more concerned with? Allah being happy with you or some person being happy with you? You have to ask yourself that question. And if in your mind and my mind, the fear of someone being upset is bigger than the fear of Allah being upset with you, then what happened to فَلَا تَخْشَوْهُمْ وَخْشَوْنِي? Don't be afraid of them, be afraid of me, Allah says. That means somebody else's fear is bigger in my heart than the fear of Allah. If that's not shirk, I don't know what is. You don't have to have an idol in front of you to do shirk. You could just have fear of people more than you have the fear of Allah. The fear of somebody's disappointment than the fear of Allah. And when you have the fear of Allah and you say, I cannot do it, and then people might embarrass you, that's okay, because Allah honored you. People might say, oh, you can't do it? Really? Can't even do this much? You're such a disappointment. Yeah, people might think you're a disappointment. But if you're being honest, and you're, instead of lying about fulfilling your trust, and then violating Allah's commandments, you would rather be straight with Allah, even if it disappoints somebody else. If you can take that road, that's a much better road for your life. And the thing about making people happy, let me just break it to you. Here's those of you that are old enough already know this, and those of you that are earlier in life will learn this along the way. رِضَ النَّاسِ غَايَةٌ لَا تُدْرَكْ. Making people happy is a canyon that has no bottom. You see, people will never be happy. The people that you're so afraid of disappointing will be disappointed about something else. Or something. And when you do everything, you bend all of Allah's rules to make someone happy, then at the end of the day, they say, you never make me happy. You never once made me happy. And you're like, but I made Allah unhappy just to make you happy. I violated everything else to just make someone else happy. And this is not the game you want to play with yourself. You're not doing anybody else a favor. You're not doing yourself a favor. The only way right is when we give people the rights that they deserve. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّ الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. And to understand that, to understand what this amana is, it's not just physical things. Like, you know, the most easy example of an amana is not just some agreement, like a aqd. It's something as simple as if somebody said, hey, can you hold on to my car? Just leave it in the garage, don't drive it. I'll be back in a week. Right? And you go joyriding on the weekend in their car. You know, they're not going to find out. They don't check their odometer. You know, it's all good. They're not going to know. When this is you violating a trust in the physical, in the material sense. You took somebody's thing that they trusted you with, and then you violated it. But more importantly, it's rights and responsibilities. And a lot of times, rights and responsibilities are not, this is the next, you know, dimension of this that I'd like you to think about. There are rights and responsibilities that are not stated. They're understood. They're under, like a friend that spoke to you. Hey man, I got this problem. I want to talk to you about it. This stays between us, right? And then sometimes they say, this stays between us, right? And other times they don't say that. They don't say it stays between us. But is it understood? Yeah, it's absolutely understood. Because they wouldn't be, they didn't post this on Facebook. They didn't make an announcement about it. They didn't, you know, write to the local paper about it. They talked to you. They trusted you. Al-majalis bil-amana. So when they trust you with a secret or a problem, and then you go, man, you know, Kareem, he's got this problem. I didn't even know. So sad, right? Yeah, he told me himself. Wow. You didn't just hurt Kareem. Or Zainab, or Fa, whoever you hurt. You didn't just hurt them. You violated Allah's commandment. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّ الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِيَا. If I'm guilty of it, and you're guilty of it, you have to look in the mirror. Forget, and when we hear a khutbah like this one, I myself and you were like, I can think of someone who this applies to. Man, I wish they heard this. I gotta send them this. I hope they get it. But the problem with all of that is, we have to look in the mirror and say, when have we done it? When have you and I done it? And we have. We have. The honest truth is we have. We forget. This is one of those things, that a line that easily gets crossed. Amana that's easily violated. And we have to take a step back and not just be very quick to pass judgment on someone else and say, man, I wish they knew. Oh, are they in trouble or what? See, even Allah is angry with them. Instead of that obsession with passing judgment on someone else, how about you and I look at ourselves and say, where am I not fulfilling an amana? Where am I not doing right? And the biggest amana of all is the amana you and this is what I wanted to hold off until the end for. The biggest trust of all is Allah's trust. It's Allah's trust. Allah has trusted you and me, the Muslims, to carry this Quran. Allah trusted you and me to be loyal to His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And you and I know when we are breaking Allah's rules and we are breaking Allah's expectations. We know it and we don't see a consequence immediately and we do it anyway. We don't think about it. So it's the people whose rights we violate, but it's also Allah's rights that we violate. Because there's no immediate consequence, right? Allah didn't make this world a world of immediate consequences. So it's not like when you lie, Allah sends lightning from the sky and strikes your tongue. He doesn't do that. It's not like when you cheat, your hand gets electrocuted. It doesn't happen. You know, Allah did not give us immediate consequences for our actions. So we start taking Allah's commandments loosely. Because when you break something, when you break Allah's rules, and you don't see yourself getting in trouble, like, you know, if you cut a red light and the camera went off, the camera flashed, something in you goes, oh, there's a hopelessness that dawns on you, you know? Or if you're driving too fast and you see the red flashing lights behind you, you're like, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi. That's a good time to remember Allah, you know? Taqwa comes immediately, right? In occasions like that. But you know, imagine that you're cutting, you're violating, and you're not getting in trouble. You didn't get caught. And when a person, you know, when someone doesn't get caught, my teacher used to give the example that, you know, even in, I'll give you my own example, in the classroom, if I'm a teacher, and there are kids in my classroom, and one kid writes on his desk, and I said on the first day, hey, nobody should write on their desk. Okay, everybody got that? Yes, yes, teacher, nobody's gonna write on their desk. And this one kid writes on his desk. And he sees that I just saw him. He puts his pencil away. He goes, I just caught him, but I don't say anything. I don't say anything. The next day he thinks I'm not looking. He does it again. And I look at him again, and I just do this. But I don't say anything. And he goes, oh, sorry. But then he gets a little brave. And he starts doing, and he sees me and he goes, I know. And a time comes where he's so used to it that he's not even looking up. Or a time comes he's looking at me straight in my eyes and going, because I'm not stopping him. I'm not punishing him. And at the end of the entire school year, I say, hey, so I'm sending you to the principal's office. Why? Because I asked you not to write on your desk and you wrote 207 times. I recorded all of them. There you go. It sounds like a pretty harsh punishment at that time, because you're not getting punished for one thing. You thought this entire time you're getting away with it, but I'm not talking about a teacher, and I'm not talking about a desk, and I'm not talking about a classroom. I'm talking about you, me, and Allah. When we cross Allah's line, He doesn't catch us right away. He doesn't stop us. And even though we feel bad, we're like, astaghfirullah, sorry Allah, I'm not going to do it again. And then you kind of do it again, cross the amana again, and He doesn't catch you again, and you're like, sorry. But you don't look that sorry anymore. And slowly but surely, the amana disappears. And you and I become comfortable disobeying Allah. Comfortable disobeying Allah. But that the fact that Allah didn't catch us doesn't mean it's not recorded. It doesn't mean you and I aren't going to stand in everything we did. لا يغادر صغيرة ولا كبيرة إلا أحصاها. It didn't leave out anything small, anything big, except that He caught it. This is the mindset of a Muslim. We get away with nothing. There is no such thing as I got away with it, or this secret is going to stay a secret, because there is no such thing as a secret. There is no such thing as a secret. Allah says in Quran, there's ما يكون من نجوى ثلاثة إلا هو رابعهم ولا خمسة إلا هو سادسهم ولا أدنى من ذلك ولا أكثر إلا هو معهم أينما كانوا. He says, never do three people meet in secret. The fourth one in the meeting is Allah. Never do five people meet in secret. The sixth one is Allah. Never do less people than that meet or more people than that meet that Allah is with them wherever they are. Wherever they are. That's a mindset. It's not just something to read in the Quran. It's a mindset. And it changes the way we behave. No matter where we are, no matter what conditions we find ourselves in, we abide by giving people their rights. Their financial rights. Their emotional rights. The rights to being honest with them. The rights that Allah has, you know, secured. There are some rights that Allah has written. Parents' rights, Allah has written. Children's rights, Allah has written. Husband and wife's rights, Allah has written. Those rights, Allah has dedicated. We don't get to play with them. They are what they are. We have to fulfill them. Whether you're the one on top, like the, you know, Allah has given some people authority, like the parent or the guardian, you have to fulfill your rights just because you're in a position of authority. No. Or whether you're on the bottom. Both. They have to fulfill their rights. And it's only after that, and this will be next week's khutbah, inshallah. وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ. But before I close, I want to share with you one last ayah of the Quran about this idea of fulfilling rights. And that's from Surah Al-Anfal. Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَخُونُوا اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولِ. People who have faith, listen up. Don't violate and don't cheat Allah and the Messenger. Don't cheat Allah and the Messenger. And then he goes on to say, وَتَخُونُوا أَمَانَاتِكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. And he says, don't cheat Allah and his Messenger, i.e. You know what i.e. means? That is to say, what I mean by that is, don't cheat the trust that you've been given. And you know what you're doing. That's called Ataf Bayan in Arabic. What is Allah saying in that ayah? When you and I cheat our trusts, we are actually cheating Allah and the Messenger. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we're doing so knowingly. This is the seriousness of the trust that you and I, every single one of us, has been handed. No human being on this earth lives without trusts. No, there's no one that says, oh, thank God I have no responsibilities. I don't know anything to... No, sorry. Since you came on this earth, you and I have them. We owe responsibilities. May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us of those who recognize when we are violating trust, recognize the seriousness of it, and we mend our course and correct our path, no matter how difficult it is for us to mend our path. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Alhamdulillahi wa kafa wa salatu wa salamu ala ibadihi alladhina astafa khususan ala awalihim wa khatam al-Nabiyyin Muhammadin al-Amin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد عباد الله رحمكم الله اتقوا الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله